So you know the definition of your client ESP now. So just to repeat it, it's you are given a set of endpoints on the plane, and the task is to compute a shortest round trip through that contains all the points on the plane. And as mentioned before, the problem is NP hard, and assuming ETH, you cannot improve the 2 to the square root n optimal algorithm for your client ESP. It works, the lower bound and upper bound is tight in higher dimensions. So just as before, we need to settle for approximation. And PTAS is basically the polynomial time algorithm that gives you 1 plus epsilon longer 2 when epsilon is a constant. And as before, we have two classic algorithms by Arora and Mitchell, who both gave PTAS in the 90s, and they both received a Goodall Prize for it. And now the difference between this and NetStock is I'm trying to improve the worst case running time of this algorithm. And the previous state of the art is Rao and Smith algorithm, which works in 1 over epsilon to the 1 over epsilon time times n log n time. And if you look at the other regime, when n is when the running time is required to run in linear time, that there is also an algorithm by Barter and Gottlieb that runs into the 1 over epsilon to some constant times n time. And both of these algorithms are really complicated, and to the best of my knowledge, they were never implemented in practice. And our contribution, the result is a better dependence on epsilon time algorithm. And I want to also convey that this is a way simpler algorithm than both of this. The simplicity of this result is basically small modification of Arora algorithm. Okay. You will see it in a second. Okay. So our main contribution is something that we call sparsity sensitive patching technique, and it also translates to higher dimensions. So if you look at the arbitrary dimension, our dependence would be 2 to the 1 over epsilon to the d minus 1 time. And assuming gap ETH, there is no way to improve this dimension even to the 1 over epsilon divided by log 1 over epsilon. So this is what I mean by optimum, assuming this gap exponential time hypothesis. Okay. Yes, and we also remove the log, and you will see the exact algorithm in a second. And it also translates to the rectilinear Steiner tree or the Steiner tree. It also gives you the gap ETH type algorithm for rectilinear Steiner tree. Unfortunately, we didn't manage to prove a lower bound for Steiner tree. This is our open problem. And the previous best for algorithm for Steiner tree was this squared. Okay. It's better for the. So now let me sketch the roadmap for the talk. So we are here. I will now briefly tell you about the Arora's algorithm. Then I will sketch what is going on in the previous algorithm with the Rao and Smith. I will tell you what are the roadblocks on improving this epsilon dependence for them. And then I will sketch the sparsity sensitive patching technique, and I will tell you the what our simple algorithm looks like, and then try to prove, wave my hands and try to prove it, and give you the gap ETH lower bound. Okay, so we start here. Now let me recall you what is the Arora's algorithm. So you are given this points on the plane, and they are bounded by this box. And first step is to round these points to be integers. And this is what he calls snapping to the grid. So I want to work on the integers, not on the real numbers. So what he introduced, a shifted squat. So he randomly selects a line on the plane, and he dissects the plane into quarters. And then if the quarter is empty, then he stops, or if it contains one point, it stops. But if it contains more than one point, she tries to recurse. So in this case, we stop here, and we recurse here and here. And now we're on the first level of a quad tree, where when we also have quad runs, and we also recurse. And now we're on the final level of a quad tree. So this is the second level of a quad tree. Okay, so this is the first step of this algorithm. Try to find this randomly shifted quad tree. This is what I mean by the quad tree. And then what Aurora does, he adds log n over epsilon equidistance portals on each edge of the quad tree. So as you can see, these portals are on this edge, there is the same number of portals as on this edge. So if you go deeper into the quad tree, the number of portals is the same, but the precision increases. Okay. And I will call an edge portal respecting if it goes through the, if it crosses the quad tree through the portal. So this edge is not portal respecting, but this one is. Okay. So the main structural theorem of the Aurora is as follows. If you are given this blue optimum solution to your Euclidean TSP instance, there exists a 1 plus epsilon longer tour that is also portal respecting. So this step is basically only costing you 1 over epsilon, 1 plus epsilon in terms of the length of the tour. And then what Aurora does is he starts at the very bottom, and he uses this dynamic programming to compute a shortest tour. So I don't want to bother you with the details, but basically it is to find a shortest path cover for a given matching on portals. So he first guesses which portals are used. This is log n over epsilon portals. And then he guesses the non-trusting matchings on these portals. And then and these are basically the states of his DP. So the running time is n log n distinct cells, and number of possible matchings is 2 to the g, where g is this number of portals. And the running time is n to the 1 over epsilon. So the structure of theorem of Aurora is as follows. So you are given this, we'll say that tours are light if it will cross the quad tree at exactly our time. So this tour is not too light because it crosses more than two times, but this is because each cell is crossed of the tour is crossed of the quad tree is crossed only twice. And more precisely, the structure theorem says that with high probability, if you have selected this quad tree at random, there will exist a tour that goes through it only 1 over epsilon times and costs you only 1 plus epsilon more, epsilon times more than the original cost. And and he proves it by basically saying that by designing something that he calls patching procedure to this optimum, and he gets he looks at the optimum, and he tries to design a tour that is light. So if the tour is crossing it less than 1 over epsilon times, then what you are doing is you are snapping the crossings of this tour to the closest portals, and the cost is basically the length of the portal border times number of crossings divided by the granularity of your portals. And if the tour is crossing it more than 1 over epsilon, then he basically says that, okay, we can use this patching procedure and buy this whole line, and this will cost you 2 times this length of the border. What he designs is he shows that this only increases the cost to the one crossing by epsilon. and on expectation, and this will mean that number of crossings is the length of the tour. So on expectation, that the length of this new portal respecting tour is only 7 times longer. So you can improve this previous running time by doing this analysis. Okay, everyone on the same page. So this is a classical algorithm. Let me tell you something that you probably didn't know. And this what you didn't know is the algorithm of Rao and Smith, which is not that well known. But basically, what they introduced, the new idea of Rao and Smith, is to introduce a spanners. So a spanner of a point set on the plane is a graph, and not necessarily a planar graph, such that if you look at two edges of this two points, pair of points, then the length of this shortest path between these points is basically 1 plus epsilon longer than the original one. So this is a spanner of a Euclidean graph. And what they claim is that there is, if you look inside of this spanner, then you can compute, you will only lose epsilon times the length of the opt by looking on the edges of this spanner instead of the planar metric. And I don't want to get.
Which is the load set of this spanner?
The original ones, the original one, the original vertices. So they can find something that is like spanner, and what they are doing now is they designed a very clever procedure that shows that you can modify your spanner such that each quadricell is intersected at most 1/ε to the 4 times. Okay, I don't want to get into details of that, but basically they say that you can modify it in such a way that these edges are only crossed 1/ε to the 4 times, and then their big idea is to place these portals as this intersection of these edges of the spanner with the edges of the cells of the grid of the quadri. Okay, and as you can see, this is getting more and more complicated. So you can ask yourself whether I can get another bell or whistle to this to make this epsilon dependence even better. And unfortunately, there are a couple of problems with it. The running time is basically, by the way, this. So there are problems that the spanners, the lightness of the spanners cannot be basically improved. And even if you use another class of spanners that are Steiner spanners, then this also doesn't give you anything, because this patching procedure on the spanners increases the number of portals by 1/ε. So, and there are even more problems in higher dimensions. So hopefully I convince you that going through the spanners is not a good idea to improve epsilon dependence. Let me tell you what we have done. This is a crucial part of the point of the talk. So if you are sleeping, then it's a good time to wake up. So this is what Aurora does. He has this optimum tour, and he places log n over epsilon portals on the edges of the quadri, or he basically buys the whole edges if the number of crossings is greater than 1/ε. Okay. Our idea now is to say that if the tool is using less than 1/ε, less than 1/ε, is crossing the edges of a quadri less than 1/ε times, but more than once, then we want to have a smooth trade-off between those two cases. So basically, we remove the tool, and we decrease the number of portals here, because the tool is crossing it a little in between 1 and 1/ε. And then we do the patching. So sparsity sensitive patching technique is basically saying, if the tool is crossing it k times, then you are going to place portals with granularity g that is equal to 1/ε² divided by k. And this works. This is a magic thing about this paper. Yep.
You're talking about the optimal solution. The part seems to be algorithmic.
You will see the algorithm in a second. So the algorithm is basically done to do the dynamic programming and guess how many times the curve is crossing this portals. We can afford that because it is 1/ε. There is one technical detail that I want to mention, that this technique doesn't work when k is equal to exactly one. This is the only case that it doesn't work. Then what we need to do is to guess this portal exactly, to guess this point exactly. And for that case, we are using this Aurora scheme. So we are placing flocken over epsilon portals only when the true is crossing it only once. And that's it. If you want a quick argument, this is 2^1 ε. So from the set of G of K portals, we need to select K crossings. And this is 1/ε² divided by K. Choose K. And for any K, this is 2^1 ε. So number of possible portal selection, if you have this many, this many crossings, is 2^1 ε, which is good. So let me state now the structural theorem that we prove. And this is basically very, very similar to what Aurora has, is that we say that true is 1/ε simple if it crosses a boundary, if a face of a border of a quadtree at this g/1 ε² k equidistant portals. And the structural theorem of ours is that for a random shift, the expected increase in cost is only epsilon times longer than this tool. And as I've mentioned before, there is a special case when k is equal to one. So we have to be very precise for k equal to one here. And if the true is crossing it exactly once, then you have to be in the same place. But that's it. So everyone agrees? Okay, let me tell you now how the simple algorithm can be derived from this theorem. So we do the first step exactly the same as Aurora. We find the randomly shifted quadtree. And to handle this case when k is equal to one, we apply this Aurora structure theorem when you have locken over epsilon portals, and then apply our structure theorem and then do the dynamic programming. So if the true is crossing it exactly once, we know exactly we are going to guess one of this locken over epsilon portals. And the number of states in DP is the number of cells, a portal set that we are selecting, and a non-crossing matching if you are talking about a planar case. So basically number of states is n log n, number of cells. Number of states is either, if you look here, it's better. So log n over epsilon, because there is this many possibilities when k is equal to one, or when k is equal to two or greater, we are having 1/ε² divided by k, choose k possibilities, which is already 2^1 ε, and 4, because there are four sides of the cell, and number of non-crossing matchings of 1/ε portals is 2^1 ε by that, because it's a Catalan number. So this gives you 2^1 ε times n times log n to the 5. So this is a very simple algorithm. Okay, and just let me sketch how we get rid of this log factors. So we have a complicated case that we call compressed case to reduce number of cells to big O of n. This was already known. And for higher dimensions, there's no notion of non-crossing matrix. So to avoid that, we use something that is called trunk-based approach, but it's complicated, but it gives us something for higher dimensions. And when k is equal to 1, this log n to the 4 is a little annoying. But what we are doing instead of Aurora, we are then using the Rahn-Smith idea to get rid of this log n to the 4. And the final running time of ours is looking like that. So it's linear in n. It's only exponential in 1 over epsilon. And this factor is due to the construction of this panel. So it's actually 1 over epsilon to the co of d. But yeah, that's what we get. You can think that this dependence is large, but actually it needs to be like double exponential because the problem is APX hard when d is omega of log n. Okay. And the good news is that this is tight. You cannot improve it, as I mentioned. Okay, any questions? Okay, let me give you the quick 5-minute sketch of the proof. It will be quick. And if you are interested, there's a 20-minute talk. We managed to fit it into one page in the paper, and it's very nice, but I will not have time to talk about it in full detail here. But basically, the idea is, so this is our tool. Let's say it looks like this. And let it be this set of crossings. We'll call something that is proximity of a crossing, that is the next left parent or right parent left crossing of X. And the proximity is the distance between this crossing and his left crossing, or P of X, which is the parent. And what we do, we place this equidistant portals here, which are marked by this axis. And we call the portal near if the distance to its parent is smaller than epsilon times the length of this phase. Okay, so these are the new portals. All the remaining ones are great portals. Where the distance is larger than epsilon f. And our patching strategy is a little more subtle than Aurora. So what we do, we will patch and buy only these blue regions. So if the portal is greater, is in this set G, we will put it, we will place an arrow to the closest portal to him. And what we will do in this blue region, we will do this patching lemma of Aurora. So we will basically, instead of buying the whole line as does Aurora, or buying or putting them the crossings to the closest portal, what we will do is we will perform on this blue regions the patching lemma, and we will buy only this blue regions. And so if you didn't get the previous picture, we have this situation. And what we are doing is we are doing this patching lemma of Aurora. So the optimum solution will go only once through this portals. And the magic thing that I will not prove now, but it's very nicely written in the paper, is that this also increases the cost by only because of epsilon as in the Aurora proof. Okay, so let me sketch the lower bound now. And I will just state it. So if you don't know what is gap ETH, it's some variant of exponential time hypothesis that you cannot approximate it well. And so we cannot approximate the satisfiability problem well. And basically, this proof will follow basically from the known construction for TSP. So if you look at this proof of Debye, For the exact Euclidean TSP, it more or less transfers to the approximate setting. Something that happens non-trivial in this paper is a result for rectilinear Steiner tree, because there was nothing known about exact complexity of rectilinear Steiner tree in terms of the lower bounds. So we have to discover the proof for the rectilinear Steiner tree and then transfer it to GAP-TH. But the problem with Steiner tree problem and proving the lower bounds for it is that you don't have a freedom where to place the Steiner points. But this is the reason why it doesn't work for Steiner tree. So we combine the modern finder and complexity techniques that are basically Q-point theorem and graph embedding, but I will not talk about it more. The big open question, some open question is whether you can prove the same for Steiner tree. Okay. So to conclude, we give a quite simple, in my opinion, a randomized algorithm for TSP rectilinear Steiner tree on Steiner tree. We also prove a matching lower bound. This improves some state of the art. And I will leave you with this open questions, whether you can get a deterministic time algorithm or prove a matching Steiner tree, or find some other nice applications of this sparsity sensitive patching. Okay, thank you.